Good evening. Welcome to the Vortex Sarasota Show. I'm your host, George Lewis. I've got a great guest tonight. You're going to have a lot of fun with him, Steve McAllister. Steve is really kind of a Renaissance guy, aren't you?
Yeah, it's kind of the term I use, is Renaissance man.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, you fit the bill completely.
Thanks.
I met Steve some time ago. Geez, I guess a couple of years ago.
Yeah, something like that.
2-3 years ago.
It was a home resource event over there.
Exactly. And, we had a good time. And I think Mandy was in it. Well, no, it was Christine.
Christine Alexander.
Alexander, yes. Was in a play. Yeah. Uh-huh. I haven't seen her for a while either.
Oh, yeah. I had lunch with her last week. She's awesome.
So you do an awful lot of different things.
I
so
do.
We won't have any problem filling some time up here, I'm quite sure. Let's talk a little bit about your first book,
okay.
The McAllister Code.
Okay.
Tell us how that came about. Give us an idea of what the meat of the book generally, and then let's talk.
Well, it's not my first book actually. It's was my third, and will probably be my sixth.
Right.
The idea for the McAllister Code came because someone put out a hoax email that said that my book, The McAllister Code, had been picked out for publication, and it was about aliens who came to Sarasota and liked it so much they wanted to turn it into a marketing mecca.
Oh, that was in the email.
That was in the email. That's an actual true life event that actually
did happen. Do you have any idea who sent that email?
I have an idea, but I'm not sure. No one has actually fessed up yet.
I got you.
And so I went to find out who it was, and I even tracked down an email, and it was like from Gulfgate PR or something, which doesn't exist. And so
I read that. That was part in your blog too, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm,
yeah.
And so I emailed them and said, thank you for the great PR, but I didn't write the book. You know, it's been a very busy year.
Right.
Perhaps I forgot or something like that. And 2 days later, another press release came out, and they quoted me in the press release and said that it was like an all-time bestseller in Amazon and just all this stuff. And so I kind of dismissed it. But I really liked the idea of the whole aliens, and I was working on this project that I now call The Unbroken Path, and wanted
I recall that now,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I wanted a way to portray it with a little more fun, and so I used that context and used The Unbroken Path as the outline for the book. And so I put it out as The McAllister Code in a limited edition paperback, but I was never really sold on the idea, the title of it.
Right.
So I basically retitled it, rebranded it, and now it is How to Survive an Estrellarian Mind Meld.
Okay, so it's the same book.
It's the same book.
Second edition.
Mm-hmm.
I got you.
Yeah.
I got you.
So I may still, I think there are still some, there's more writing left. I've continued the story in another, in a sequel, basically.
Right.
And so I'm thinking further on down the line, when the other books gain steam, I may package them together and call that the McAllister Code, but who knows.
Well, I think that happens with authors more often than not.
Yeah.
It's like it's a process, and it seems like they're never done.
Yeah.
I've written a book, and I go back, and I get little excerpts from it, and I think, well, maybe I ought to rewrite this. I guess it's arts kind of that way.
Sure.
There's an interesting story here if you ever found out who sent you the email.
Oh, yeah.
You did find that out?
No, I haven't found out yet. Not for sure.
Because I wonder what their reaction to your actually writing the book must be. It must be, it's like...
I'd love to find out.
I bet you would. I bet you would. So, Iman and Yule, right?
Iman and Yule.
Iman and Yule.
Mm-hmm.
You think they had anything to do with it?
Maybe so. It's funny. I mean, I come from a Christian background, my mid-20s, I had really a crisis of faith, or a crisis of belief system, I should say. I still had faith in a higher and a
right.
higher God. And so when I started writing this book, the names, Estrellarian, for one, just kind of popped into my head. I didn't realize why until looking at it a little bit more. And Iman and Yule were the same way.
Right.
Where Estrellarian is kind of a derivative of the word Easter. And Iman and Yule are Emmanuel, God
right.
with us. And so that's really the crux of the book. I kind of, hide it through a lot of different things, but that's really it, is just realizing who we are, that God is with us, and that we are that that power working in the world.
So you actually you moved from a Christian background.
Mm-hmm.
How strong was that with you?
It was pretty strong. I mean, I grew up in Lutheran church, and then
right.
Got involved with the Baptists when I was about 15. you know, and it was Southern Baptist, so it was very fundamentalist evangelical. And, you know, just met this group of people that were excited about what they believed and sharing it and all that stuff. And I never felt inclined to become an evangelist. And so, you know, I did a little evangelism, but I never felt strong about it.
Right.
But I was very, very involved in the church. And, you know, I mean, still to this day, Jesus is one of the greatest spiritual teachers and one of my personal heroes.
Yeah. Just from a different viewpoint.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
See him as more of a prophet or a teacher or
yeah, I think so. You know, and it's more that's one way to look at it. You know,
right.
with a fundamentalist evangelical mindset, you have to look at it as a fact, and that's fine. That's all well and good, but I mean, I look at it as broader than that. You know, there was this the film came out a few years ago, the Zeitgeist film.
Right,
you're familiar with that?
Yep.
And they started pointing out how all of these things about Jesus, you know, the virgin birth, the death, the crucifixion, resurrection, all that kind of stuff, are seen in other stories and traditions and stuff. And so they use that to kind of break apart the Christian tradition and say it's all hogwash. It's just,
right,
you know, pulled from all these different things. I look at that and I say, well, that actually lends more credence to it, that there's something here. That this is, these ideas are distributed throughout cultures and traditions and for me, that says, okay, maybe I should pay a little bit more attention to what this actual, the true message really is. You know, not the message of Paul that the Christian church now really uplifts, but more the message of Christ and you know, the golden
Paul really kind of hijacked that whole thing.
Oh, very much so.
Yeah, he was like, as a matter of fact, he didn't know Jesus at all.
Mm-mm.
Yeah. It was strictly through revelation.
Yeah.
And who can say what he was, you know, revelating.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Tell me about, let's tell our audience about how aliens were going to turn Sarasota into a marketing mecca, because that's a very interesting idea.
Uh-huh.
And give us just a little synopsis.
Well, first, I didn't know what a marketing mecca was exactly. I had to kind of piece that together a little bit. You know, Mecca being the place where the Muslims
all
pray to. And so I think that whoever wrote the press release wanted, you know, had a vision for Sarasota becoming that kind of place where this concept of marketing, of more than just advertising, but really expressing ideas and realizing, you know, marketing is the whole process of your business, really, of how you get what it is you get and create it,
right,
and you know, take it to market and distribute it, and there's a whole thing to that. And so where I ended up going with the book is kind of this realization that just as it is in business, the marketing is the whole thing. Our lives need to be kind of like that. And a few years ago, I did a little short film called Water, Bird, Plant, and Man.
Uh-huh.
And the subjects were, it was based on a little photography experiment I did, but the subjects were the water and a bird and plants on the beach and men, and the fishermen came.
Right.
And I realized that that each of those things represented the four elements of nature, water, air, earth, and fire.
Right.
And when you look at humanity, we have those same elements within us. You know, we're a mirror of nature, really, with our emotional body being water.
Absolutely.
Our minds being of the air, our bodies being of the earth, and our spirits being a fire.
One of the big mistakes we make, I think, is separating ourselves from that fact.
Right.
From that reality, Steve. I think that's really important.
Yeah, I think that's a big part of why we're seeing a lot of the problems that we are in the world right now, because we've separated ourselves, you know, not only from God, but from
nature
as well.
Yeah. We see ourselves somewhere else outside and above.
Right.
It's insanity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it really is.
Complete insanity.
Yeah, so I took that idea and then built in an idea that was shared with me through Gail Fulton Ross, who's a local artist here. And she had this concept of artists must play cards. And her cards was an anagram, I think. Is that what it's called? Anagram.
Yeah.
Of commitment, ambition, resourcefulness, dedication, and then solitude.
Right.
And so each of those applies to, you know, commitment of the heart, ambition of the mind, resourcefulness of the body, and then dedication of the spirit. And so each of those things is, you know, how we really come to become the marketing people that we are, if you will, create a market for ourselves.
Right. Well, you know what's also interesting about that is that I think Sarasota, I'm quite sure Sarasota is a spiritual mecca.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's been hidden. That fact has been hidden for quite a while. But what do you know about the sand at Siesta Beach?
I know that it's quartz. I know it's very fine. You know, I know that there have been talks about there being vortices here in Sarasota, and the same you find in Sedona, mm-hmm. Asheville, different areas like that kind of just have this vortex that draws spiritual people and gives out spiritual energy. And I think that most people who come to visit here with that mindset, as long as you're open to that, then you're gonna feel it.
Sure. Well, you know, did you come here, or were you born here?
I was born here.
Okay.
I'm an actual native.
You know, the sand out there is 99.9% crystalline quartz. Mm. That's Harvard sent a team down here, and they're from their geology department.
Right.
That's pretty powerful. Sure. When you think about quartz and, you know, how quartz is used, it's, you know, in communication, it's like in healing and in a lot of different ways.
Right.
And you take a town like, say, some small town in Missouri, mm-hmm. What do you think the chances of the healers that we have here, the new age kind of things, what do you think the chances of somebody like you living in a little town in Missouri?
I don't think that's very feasible.
Pretty slim, isn't it? Pretty slim. So yeah. I think there's some real validity to that. As far as the vortice thing, Steve, when you look at the hurricanes, mm-hmm. something goes on here.
Yeah.
Because they go around us.
Yeah.
They flat out go around us. So
yeah.
I'm convinced there's something going on here in the way of vortices or whatever. Mm-hmm. You did an interview with Spiritually Raw radio show?
I did, yeah. That was a while ago.
How'd that go?
Well, actually, I had done a... I'd done like they do like a pre-interview kind of thing,
mm-hmm.
and the pre-interview went fine, and you know, they ask all their guests, do you want to hear more about this guy? And they're like, yeah, we do. And then they never followed up, and when I tried to follow up, they're like, oh yeah, and we never did our follow-up interview.
Oh, that's so interesting.
Yeah.
Well, I just booked them. We're gonna have their show on, I think, 5 or 6 days a week.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they just produced a bunch of one-hour shows, so I was really interested in your experience with them. So.
Yeah, it's very limited, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll get back at there. You know, and right about that time, I was also just putting the McAllister Code book out there. And shortly after that, I was like, I just wasn't really comfortable with the whole McAllister Code as a title and putting that brand out. So
right.
That may have been a little bit of my hesitancy in really putting it out there at the time.
Well, I think you know, like when I see how all this came about, mm-hmm. I think it took a pretty good set of it took courage, you know, like to really put yourself out there.
Thank you.
The way that you have, and mm-hmm. you know, one of the things I really admire about you is that you're doing, I believe, as best you can, your dream,
yeah.
And you're living your life the way you feel you should live your life.
Yeah.
And darn few people make it to that point, Steve. Yeah. I think you know that.
Oh, yeah.
You know, which is, and there needs to be more of us.
Right.
That, you know, like follow that inner guidance, mm-hmm. rather than the head stuff and looking for the approval and all that that's never there anyhow.
So, right. Yeah, know. I had, you know, I mean, this society especially, we still have a lot of our industrial mindset that says, you know, you're this, do this, do this. And I never really fit into that, you know. But by the time I was 29, I'd worked I don't know how many different jobs from all kinds of different things and often juggling a few of them at the same time.
Right.
I came to this point where I was kind of like, why am I not fitting in? And did a little research, and this whole ADD diagnosis came up. And it really matched what I was going through. But
right.
When I look at my society, I'm thinking, y'all are much more messed up than I am in many ways.
For sure.
And yeah. So I started looking at it from the basis of Tom Hartman is one of the writers who looks at the positive aspects of ADD.
Right.
And so I started looking at, okay, if I have these strengths, then how can I use these strengths to create the life that I want and hopefully help someone else to see what their potential is instead of just being drugged and, you know, called disordered and have to deal with that, you know, in their self-esteem and whatnot. So that was really when I said, okay, you know what? I'm really going to go for it. And I dropped everything. And
you were 29 at this point?
I was 29. And so I left and I wrote, which was then my second book, The Rucksack Letters, where I took a year and a half and I traveled the country and hitchhiked across and visited a lot of different
That's
types
where you
of
lost your camera or something, hopping rails?
I did lose a camera hopping rails, yeah. I was hopping trains, yeah.
That's a good experience.
It was a lot of fun.
Oh, I'm sure it was.
Yeah, it wasn't as successful as I would have liked to be, because hopping trains, you don't know where you're going to go.
You haven't got a clue, do you?
Yeah, and I did want to go to New Mexico from Colorado, and then the train started taking me to Kansas, and I was like, no, I don't want to go back to Kansas.
I don't have my red slippers, right?
Right, exactly.
Forget that, I'm not going,
yeah.
No way.
So when the train stopped, I hopped off and hitchhiked back to Colorado and then hitchhiked down to New Mexico.
Well, were you making a film of that? Was that your plan,
no,
or you just had your camera?
I wanted to write. It was more about the Jack Kerouac experience,
right,
as a writer than it was as a filmmaker.
Right.
And technology wasn't as it is today.
Changed hugely.
The 10 years is incredible. Where you think, I was thinking about it when the turn of the decade, when, 10 years before, I had this, big desktop computer that had like 4 gigs to it, and, now I have an iPhone that is more powerful than the desktop.
Considerably
that I had
more powerful.
Oh, incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I didn't have any kind of, the camera that I lost was a little thing, but, it had pictures that I wanted to see again, I wanted other people to see, but, so stuff gets lost and you just let it go.
It's gone. Well, it wouldn't be worth anything right now except for memory anyhow.
Yeah, right.
I think 10 years from now, Steve, there's a good possibility, instead of sitting here like we are with a couple of cameras and, mm-hmm. and a sound system, we would be immersed in some kind of, what's the reality? Lost the term.
Estrellarian mind meld?
There you go. Yeah, an Estrellarian mind meld. The... what is it when you're immersed in the...
Like a hologram kind of thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't. I lost it. So we'll forget that and go on. So you, how many films have you done? You've done a couple, 3 films, right?
Well, a lot of the films that I do are the short films, And
right.
We should just call them videos more than films. I've worked on quite a few films for other people and whatnot. But as far as, what I would consider a major film, still working on much smaller stuff. Like my first one that I consider a film is a short script that I wrote. It's about a 20-minute film called Lesson Learned.
Uh-huh.
And it was about an Iraq vet who comes back and he's wounded and has gone through this terrible experience over there. And he goes to speak to his grandfather, who was a World War II vet, and never talked about his experience.
Oh, wow.
As many World War II vets, they don't talk about.
Absolutely.
It. And so the grandson and the grandfather come together, and the grandson is trying to get answers for why he feels the way that he does and how he comes to peace with what he's done over there.
So it's a documentary?
No, it was a narrative. It was an actual story that I wrote and with Susan, I forget her last name right now. But yeah, so it was a story that I wrote. Since then, I usually do a lot of documentary stuff.
Right.
Just because I like to just show what's actually is. Reality is so much more interesting than fiction sometimes. So I do a lot of documentary.
Sometimes I don't think we can make up what goes on in reality. It's like,
yeah,
pretty amazing.
True.
So I've got a whole list of things here that you are. You're a filmmaker, mm-hmm. a writer. You play guitar?
I do.
You sing?
I do.
You are a drummer?
I can.
Kind of.
When the mood strikes me.
A photographer?
Uh-huh.
Publisher?
Yeah.
Actor?
Uh-huh.
How do you compare with your sweet wife?
Ex-wife now. But,
is that right?
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that.
Well, it was one of those things. We were just the third year of our marriage was just really rough, and I was feeling pulled in one direction and she was in another, and both of us were kind of at that point where we said, we've got to do our own thing for a while, and so we're still best friends.
Right.
It's taken us a while to get back into that relationship, but we split up a little over a year ago, and the divorce was final in October, I think, but now we've got a great relationship, so.
It's interesting how that works out.
Yeah,
it really
is.
You end up being better friends.
Yeah, and I think, and we had talked about it a lot when we were married, and then, of course, afterward as well, and today's situation, 50% of all the marriages end in divorce anyway.
They sure
do. And it's one
of
those things.
The other 50 didn't bother getting married.
Yeah, right. So I think it's one of those things, just start looking at it in a more healthy way. Say, this doesn't have to be, you don't have to be enemies. You just have to realize your relationship is transitioning. That the concept of marriage, while it works great for some, and some people want to adhere to that type of tradition, that's wonderful. But other people, it's not realistic in today's today's culture and the way that we move and operate and change so much.
Well, it's really very difficult. Mm-hmm. You know, I think communications plays a huge role in that. We're not so isolated as we once were. You know, back in the 50s, television was really just kind of getting popular, and radio was the big means of communication for most people, and it just was a whole different world, a whole different mindset.
Yeah.
In that.
Well, I think in some degree, I think that may have something to do with the breakdown of the family. You know, a lot of people bemoan the breakdown of the family and the rising divorce, and I think that since television, I think it's a great medium. It is what it is. Nevertheless, we spend so much of our time, our family time, sitting in front of the television, not talking to one another.
Huge.
Have this stuff programmed into us. And now we're coming back to this place where we're able to create our own content and put that out through the internet and through making these videos, that kind of thing. And so I think it's opening us up again, which is why I think you see a lot of the social media expanding the way that it is, because we want that connection again. And so now we're like, wow, we have the tools to do it. So
absolutely.
It's great.
So you're pretty strong on social media?
I'm pretty strong. I get by.
Have you met anybody that you've met online, through the social media? Have you been face to face with them?
Oh, sure.
Yeah, me too. But, I hear people talking all the time about that online experience takes away and detracts from the one on one. But I don't think so. It for me, it kind of enhances it. It brings people together.
I think so. I mean, I was telling a friend the other day, we were sitting around and talking about stuff we saw on Facebook, and I'm like, isn't it great we can get around and talk about the things we do on Facebook? And it's true that we kind of can cut to the chase on a lot of issues. Wow. Because our time seems to be so much more limited now. We have this opportunity to just kind of check up on what people are doing, what they're involved with, what they find interesting, so that when we do see them, we can say, oh, I really liked what you said about this. And the conversation can continue.
You've got a conversation where it's hard.
Exactly.
It takes icebreakers and all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You have a couple of websites.
I did. I've stripped those down because, as you may know, I don't use money anymore. I haven't used money since November.
Talk to me about that. That's very interesting.
Well, it was when I left her to do the rucksack letters. That was kind of part of it there, where I was. I've never been very good with money anyway, and saw it as such a focus in so much of our society. And so that experience kind of opened me up to the possibilities a little bit more. I still used money, obviously. But then this last year, in 2011, dealing with my divorce and having the time to heal from that, and I went back to work for some other people after working at the hospital for 4 years. And I had like two or three different jobs where we got to a certain point and they ran out of money, and they couldn't pay me anymore, and so that was obviously frustrating for me. But then also looking at what's going on in the rest of the world, where we have this recession and everybody's everybody I talk to, it seems like, I wish I had more money.
Everybody got hit by this.
Yeah. And I started looking into it, and we got to realize that the US dollar, the Federal Reserve note, as it's called now, is only like 98 years old.
Right.
They
just recently stopped the gold standard. Wasn't that long ago.
Right, right. And so, that happened in the 70s, I believe. So you're still looking at, 30 plus years.
Right.
The average lifespan of a fiat currency, like the dollar, is 35 years.
Right.
So, we've got to kind of come to grips with this notion that that's not eternal. It's not. It's just one of those temporary measures that we've used. It's a tool that we've used for a while, but it as much as it represents value, it's not value in itself, and there's much more value to life than just the dollar. And so this experiment that I'm doing now is living this year without money, is trying to find other sources of value so that we can look at people again as people and see that everyone has value. Even if you don't have dollars or money, you still have value as a person, because a lot of people who have all kinds of money have, I don't want to say they have no value, but they have some very little value in what they bring to our culture and our community.
More they're taking than bringing.
Yeah, exactly. Because there's in this monetary-based system, there's this hoarding mentality.
Well, what's interesting about money is it really is only a way to exchange energy.
Yeah.
There could well be some other way come along. I was, as a matter of fact, I was thinking about this last week. You know, how, you know, what could replace this monetary system we have? Because there's nothing backing it up. Mm-hmm. It's paper.
Okay.
It's the government's word saying we can back it up. You know, but it was the same way with Greece, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we found out they could no more back it up than anything. You know?
Oh, so right.
We're living on promises.
Yeah, and if you're watching what's going on, you know, and you're watching how these banks are dealing with this kind of stuff, it's pretty evident they can't back it up.
You know?
And unfortunately, they don't have the integrity to back it up. And that's where it's, I think, really important. And that's one of the biggest values that we miss out on in the monetary system, the way that it is, because it's so much about hoarding and so much about what I can get for myself, not what can I bring to the community. Why am I here? How can I serve? And that's, I think, what we need to get back to. It's gotta have that shift in consciousness to say, you know what, it's not just about me collecting a bunch of stuff and material goods, but back to that wisdom of Jesus, you know, not to store up treasures here, store up treasures in heaven, you know, which is still here, but it's in a different realm. You've got to look at it with different eyes in order to see it.
Well, yeah, and also the falsehood about giving us our value. Mm-hmm. Because it doesn't, you know, it doesn't no more give us our value than anything. I can't think of the show that Klein was in that, you know, the other actor had a lot of money, but he was goofy, you know, but yet everybody went to him for advice.
Uh-huh.
Because he had money, as though he would know somehow or other the answer to, you know, to life's deepest questions. He didn't. I wish we had more time. We could explore that in a whole show, I think. That's a
sure.
really interesting topic. So, but how's that working out for you? I mean,
actually quite good. You know, it's funny. I was telling a friend last week that it's like once you get past the limitation of you know, value has to come through this source,
right?
And you stop using that, then you open yourself up to the real abundance in life.
Starts to come from different
yeah.
ways, different
yeah.
directions, that kind
mm-hmm.
of thing.
Because so often we just get so narrow-minded on everything we do. We got to try to get that money, and that limited thing, which is just paper. You know, it's just. Beautiful piece of art. It's very intricate, and they're all numbered pieces of art. They're beautiful.
Engraved.
Nevertheless, there's so much more value to life, and when you open up to that, it's really it's gonna be really extraordinary. And it's extraordinary the way things just kind of pop up, like for housing and whatnot. I usually do a work exchange for housing.
Right.
Anywhere from cat sitting when someone goes away for a week or so, to you know someone needs a fence built or repairs done on their houses and stuff, and it's really funny how many times I've been at that, you know, end of my week stay of serving this person and not know where I'm going to go that next day, and something just opens up.
Right.
It just kind of pops up. So it's pretty interesting.
Is there a faith factor in there? Spiritual beliefs, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I wouldn't be doing this if I didn't believe there was a higher intelligence at work somewhere kind of guiding me into it.
Right.
You know, and I believe that I play some part in that, you know, not so much to say, you know, I feel called by God to this, but
yeah, no,
but in some way I do,
you know,
realistically.
Absolutely.
I believe that we are as a civilization going through this evolutionary period, and I think that we've got to change our values.
Really. Without question.
Yeah.
Without question. I wish we had more time. Do you believe a half hour's gone? Gone.
It's already half an hour.
Yeah, it's gone quickly.
My goodness.
We'll have to have you back at some point, Steve.
All right, we can do that.
I had a good time with you tonight.
Well, thank you very much. Good to be here.
You're an interesting guy. Well, that's unfortunately all we can do tonight, but we're going to be here next week, same time. Be sure and come back. And in the meantime, don't forget to accentuate the positive and have a fantastic week.